Jute Mills was financed by the capital of Indian Marwadi from Calcutta and the Rana rulers of Nepal, the joint venture company. So there's an industrial investment. So another way of exploitation or another way of exploitation is industrial investment. So the third way is financial investment, like you just export money, like bank capital. So, you know, if you just, so foreign banks, like the Indo-Arab, we have banks, Indo-Bangladesh Bank and the SBI Bank, so that way the capital has been exported into Nepal in the form of financial capital. So, depending on this mercantile form, industrial form or financial form, it impacts differ. So, this also you have to consider while looking into the underdevelopment of a particular country. But what Marxism says, but there has, you should not believe in determinism or nihilism. Like the external factor is totally deterministic. Since there is a foreign capital investment in Nepal, because of that, we have become poor. So that type of fatalistic or deterministic approach is not correct. It depends how that foreign investment has come. If it has come in the form of industrial investment, that may be better for our country. If it comes in the form of financial or mercantile form, it may be more detrimental, harmful to our country. So it depends on that. It's not that all foreign capital is not bad. It depends in what form it comes. If it comes in the form of productive capital, industrial capital, that may be useful for our development. But it comes just in the form of money-making capital, or the interest-seeking capital in the form of finance, or just a mercantile capital, that may be harmful to the country. So what Marxism says is, you shouldn't fall in the trap of determinism or nihilism. You should take it relatively, and you should analyze the concrete form of that investment. And so then how to judge which mode of production is more developed, or which social system is more developed and which is less developed. For this, so there are various indicators and various criteria. What I have chosen in my thesis is degree of differentiation of social division of labor and the extent of economic articulation. Like in the very backward stage of economy, every mode of production was agriculture. In those days, there was agriculture in Kathmandu Valley, there was agriculture in Humla, and there was agriculture in Morang. So in those days, there was no industry and there was no trade. The only agriculture was there in the initial stage. So there very less differentiation. The difference between in Morang, Kathmandu and Humla was all non-existent. So with the development of society, this differentiation of economic sector takes place. The labor force, which in the earlier stage totally engaged in agriculture, gradually that is shifted to the industrial sector and to the service and other sector. So the sectoral differentiation, with the development of society, the labor force starts getting transferred from one sector to another. In the earlier phase, the more almost 98-99% used to be in agriculture, but gradually, with the advent of capitalism and the higher mode of production, the labor force was shifted from agriculture to industry and to the services and the other sector. So this social differentiation is one of the indicators of development. If there is more differentiation, then this society is more developed. This is the criteria I have chosen for the study of Nepal's development. And similarly, the extent of economic articulation also I have taken, because spatially also, if there is a interaction between different areas and different territorial space and regions, that economy is more developed. Like even in the agriculture society, you don't exchange goods, so there is no interaction. There is no economic articulation between one place to another place. But when you have industrial production and then you start trading goods, then there is a lot of economic articulation between regions. So this is another indicator of higher level of development of society. So while talking of development and underdevelopment, through these indicators, if there is a more social differentiation of labor, and if there is more territorial differentiation of articulation of regions, then that region or country is more developed. But if there is less differentiation, if there is less articulation, then that region is less developed or underdeveloped. So this is the criteria I have developed to study the situation in Nepal. Next. So with this, then how the underdevelopment manifests in space? That's what I have called spatial structure of underdevelopment. Because nature and society, as you know, constantly interact with each other, and production as such is an appropriation of nature within and through a certain form of society. So what is production? Because through land, water, forest, when the human labor is applied in land, water, mineral extraction or forestation, so you produce value, you produce goods. So production means this is the interaction of human labor and nature. So that's why the production by itself is always related with nature, and the development always manifests in the territorial space. So the territory or the geography we have acquired from the very beginning keeps on changing through the changing economic activity. So that's why the original space, original territorial space gets humanized and becomes a historical nature. The original nature we have outlined, all our Tarai area was forested area. But now our present day Tarai is totally changed. You see, agriculture land and industrial and other activities have taken place, and the face of Tarai has totally changed over the last 100 years. So the original Tarai, the original territory of Tarai, and the present territory of Tarai is totally changed. So with the development of society, even the territory gets humanized, socialized. So it is no longer the pure natural territory, it becomes social and humanized territory. So this concept I have tried to inculcate in this spatial structure of underdevelopment. How the development and underdevelopment manifest in space. Then the articulation of territorial division of labor is manifested in the emergence of economic regions with the development of society. The various regions come up, like in the very beginning, Kathmandu was the center of stabilized agriculture because it was very good for climatic condition for agriculture, and it was very well located between India and China. The lowest pass traveling from Indian plain to Tibetan plateau is the Kodari. This Kodari is the among the whole Himalayas from Hindu Kush to Burma. The lowest place is about 14,000 feet is in the Kodari. So this area or the Raswagadi, they were the lowest mountain passes. So that's why Kathmandu emerged as the trading center from very beginning. So that's why Kathmandu in the beginning emerged as a developed region. Later on, when Britishers colonized India and Calcutta developed as a trading and industrial center, then the Biratnagar was the nearest point to Calcutta. So then the next development in Nepal, next region which developed more was the Biratnagar region. But later on, when more economic activity started taking place between Nepal and India, most of the trade started flowing from Birganj to Kathmandu. So then the Birganj later on developed this way. So that's why the development of region keep on shifting according to the historical level of development. So this interspatial articulation or the development of regions and the articulation between these areas keep on changing over time, and we have to study these lesser articulation between region to know their real level of development. Next. Friends, now I will enter into with this theoretical and conceptual base. Now how to study Nepal. As I told you, sectoral differentiation and territorial differentiation. I have taken two criteria for measuring of development of Nepal, and for this I have tried to analyze the specificities of Nepal. What are the geographical factor, natural factor and the historical factor which impacted on the development process of Nepal? Then now coming to the geographical factor. The geographical factor, as you all know, I can dwell in detail, but this geographical or the regional territorial positioning of Nepal, it is Indian plains and Tibetan plateau. Here the Indian plains here and the Tibetan plateau, if you see sandwich between these two areas, then you will see our geography is tilted towards India. The high mountains, then the mid hills, then the Mahabharat, then the Tsuray and the Arc plain, very narrow strip of plain we have, only this much. Here we have Tsuray, here the Mahabharat, the mid hills and the high Himalayan mountains, and the beyond the Himalayas also, there the inner Himalayas, like the Manang and the Mustang area. And then the, we have the Tibetan plateau. This is a high plateau, almost same height as the Himalayas, you see. So that way, geographically, Nepal is tilted towards India. So this has given an extraverted structure of Nepal. Though we are positioned between India and China, generally we say, why not have good relation with China? We should look towards more China. Theoretically, it sounds good. But practically what happens is, because we have been blocked by this high mountain, high Himalayas on the Chinese side, and on the Chinese side also Tibet, there is no productive area even in Chinese side. On the Tibetan plateau, a very high mountainous plateau, very less sparsely populated. So that's why even if you want to be very close with China, economically it's even higher. So that's why our most fertile area is joined with India, and we are in geographical tilted towards India. So this is one of the factors. Historically, also naturally, we are bound to be more closer to India, more interaction with India. So that gives extraverted structure, is extroverted. The foreign tilt, the outward tilt is geographically given to us. When I have tried to compare this with Switzerland, you see, Nepal is landlocked and Switzerland is landlocked. People say, only if Switzerland can develop, why can't Nepal? Because in the case of Switzerland, naturally they have the mountains on two sides, and the internal is the very homogeneous territory within Switzerland. You know, from Germany also separated by mountains, and Italy also separated by mountains. So they have been able to develop independently. So their case is different than ours. So that's why this factor, this geographical factor, has to be taken into account while studying about the process of development and underdevelopment of Nepal. Next. So this same thing I have drawn in the map. If you just a cut across from south to north, from here, this is the Tarai Plain, very narrow strip, then the Tsuray Hills, and then the inner Tarai there, and then the hill, and the mountain, and the inner Himalayas and Zion. Next. Now if you see from the south, you see this way. See, all of a sudden, the high Himalayan mountain, this is, in fact, I have cut across the western Nepal near the Pokhara. Here, this is the Kali and Nagi Valley. So just as you see, used. All of a sudden rising this Lavalagiri and Annapurna on this side. And here is the Marsangi, and here the Annapurna and the Manaslore. So this type of cross-section gives a general view, what are the impediments, what are the problems we face in the balanced development of Nepal. Next. Now the historical specificity, we have to consider some of the historical factors which contributed to the development and undevelopment of Nepal. There are certain specificities of Nepal. So I don't want to go into very detail. In recent years, there have been many studies how the people of Nepal originated, whether we really originated from here, spread outside, or we are migrant here. There is a debate among the anthropologists. Generally, earlier it used to be thought the people migrated. Nepal was a place for migrants. People from north and south and east and west migrated and they met in Nepal Valley. That was the original thesis. But the recent studies say when the people migrated from Africa and via Mediterranean, they drifted towards the east. About 70,000 years ago, they migrated to this Nepal Valley and they settled here and they developed here. So in fact, not the Mongols, but the Nepalese, the Kirats were the original. The Mongols developed, they migrated from here. So this is another thing. Earlier, the Nepalese or our Tibeto-Burman stock came from the Tibetan Burma side. But now there is another thesis which says about 70,000 years ago, one stock of people settled here in Nepal. They developed into a Mongoloid stock, and when they Kirat stock, when they migrated towards the east, then they became the Mongols. So there are different theories were there. Anyway, Nepal, what I mean to say, Nepal was a place of ancient civilization. In the first millennium, about 1000 BC, the Mongolist of Kirat and the Khas from the north and the Astrodavid from the south, they met in the Kathmandu Valley, and the Kathmandu Valley became the citadel of civilization in Nepal. So, afterwards, from Chanakya, the Arthashastra, to the Lisvi, historical evidences prove Kathmandu Valley was one of the most developed area of this region. And after the 11th century, there is another influx of the plain people from the Nepal, towards Nepal. So these people came with the more advanced technology of rice and maize cultivation, and that they were assimilated with the original people of Nepal, both the Kirat and Khas and the Astrodavid. The one other stock which came from the southern plain after the 11th century, these people came with more advanced technology, because the technology are more advanced in the Indian plains. So that made a difference in the development of Nepal. And till the 18th century, when this Nepali state was unified under the leadership of Ferdinand Shah, and when Nepal got defeated with the Britishers and had to signed the Sugauli Treaty in 1816, then two processes began. This is my thesis. So one is the endogenous process, another is the exogenous process after the 18th century. Before the 18th century, development of Nepal was carried on smoothly, because it was more of less independent development. But after the Sugauli Treaty, the external and internal factor started getting effective in the development process of Nepal. Next. So the exogenous dynamics was, since we were defeated in the Sugauli Treaty, we imposed an unequal treaty with the British colonialists. So Nepal became a political dependence. The earlier Nepal was independent. We used to carry trade with India and China through Tibet. So we are fairly, the development of Nepal was almost at equal level of development of India. All the English writers who have visited Nepal those days, if you see their books, they would say development of Nepal was in no way lagging behind other parts of the world. Nepal was as developed or as underdeveloped, whatever you might choose, was at par with South Asia, not only in South Asia, even in Europe. So the lateral, with this political dependency, gradually when the in the 1923, a treaty was signed with India, the commercial treaty. So that allowed free access of Indian goods, factory-made goods to Nepal. And that way, after the beginning of the 20th century, Nepal was converted into economic dependency. Earlier, it was a political dependency, but after the beginning of the 20th century, Nepal became an economic dependency of British India. This is one of the factors which impacted on the development, natural process of development of Nepal. And then the indigenous dynamics or the internal dynamics was after the unification of territorial integration and unification of Nepal, especially after the Suguli Treaty, when the Rana regime after 1846, Rana regime started in Nepal, autocratic rule, then the great feudalization process started. In the most of the Tarai land was cultivated then, the whole land was forested earlier, the inner, the Ture, Chivalik land. So they were deforested, land was cultivated, was distributed to the Ranas and their hangers and as the Birtas and various Bhutis. So that is the feudal land ownership pattern developed during that period. And when the forest timber was sold to India to build railways, it was during that period, especially during the period of Veer Shamsher and then Chandra Shamsher, the Indian railways were extended towards the Nepal border. So during that time, these commercial activities took place. Most of the our timber was sold to the Britishers to make the railway lines. So that was a form of commercial feudalism also developed. Basically, the feudalism and a form of commercial feudalism, commerce also developed in those days. So we need another specific factor, specialized situation of our historical journey was there was no clean break, no revolutionary rupture in Nepalese history. This is a very interesting point to note, because for development, you know, the old social system, old social relation has to be shattered through revolution. You just see the history of all the development countries. The first revolution took place in England, and then France, the American Revolution, then the Russian Revolution, Chinese Revolution, and all these revolutions shattered the old social and economic system and cultural system. That paved the ground for rapid economic development. Like Europe, take the case of Europe. When Napoleonic War from 1801 to 1815, just compared with Nepal, during that time, Nepal also was fighting with the British. Nepal state expansion drive was going on in Nepal. Whereas in Europe, there was a massive Napoleonic War. Napoleonic War destroyed all feudal system. All the monarchies were abolished. And all the feudal system, all the feudal land ownership was seized and distributed to the peasantry. So that type of revolution took place in Europe. That gave rise to industrial revolution. It's not that just industrial revolution happened by it itself. So same thing happened in America, and same thing happened in Russia, same thing happened in China. But in case of Nepal, we didn't have that type of revolution. Clean sweep of the old feudal relation or old feudal culture and society. But in Nepal, we have minor upheaval, like in 1990, we didn't have very clean break. Only after, I think, those small rebellions were there, but the big rebellion was the Maoist People's War in 1996 and 2006. That was after the Suguli Treaty. That was the largest insurgency or the revolutionary upheaval in Nepalese history. But that also was not completed. Myself being a participant of that rebellion, we can say we couldn't take it to the real conclusion, because of the national and international factor, the power balance didn't allow us to totally abolish the old feudal system. So we had to make a compromise through the 12 point understanding, all these things, you know it. So that way, the another factor we have to consider while talking about development and underdevelopment of Nepal is, in the Nepalese issue, there was a continuity. Continuity of absolute rule, when there is a continuity and when there is no break in social development, then development gets retarded and it gets slow. once it's a clean break, then we have to make a clean start and make a very rapid economic development. So this is one of the historical specificity of Nepal, which contributed to underdevelopment of this country. This is another hypothesis I put forward during my thesis. Now let's go to the next. Friends, now let's now come to different sectors of the economy. As I told you, development, higher level of development means more social differentiation and more territorial differentiation. So what is the exact general differentiation of the economy? Though I didn't have a latest data, I didn't have time to update it. If you have heard the budget speech recently, now the agriculture, generally there are three sectors of the economy, you know. Agriculture, primary sector, secondary sector and the tertiary sector. Primary sector means agriculture, fishery, forestry, and the secondary sector means industry, manufacturing, construction, and the tertiary sector means banking, services, education, health and all, etc., etc. So when these three sectors of the economy, in the early 50s, most of our labor force, more than 90% of our labor force was in agriculture. And GDP, total GDP, over the more than 80% of our GDP was contributed by the primary sector. Only about, only 20% was by the secondary and the tertiary sector, till the 50s. But gradually then, the agriculture sector started declining and the industrial sector became stagnant. And the service sector, the tertiary sector, started rising. So recently, the recent data, the latest data says the agricultural labor force is still not very differentiated. About 2/3 of our labor force is still in agriculture, whereas in developed countries, it is only about 3%, 1% to 3%. In America or Europe or more developed countries, the agricultural labor force is only less than 5%. But in our case, we still have 65% of our labor force in agriculture. And 1/3 of our GDP, 33% is the recent data says, 33%, exactly 1/3 of our GDP is contributed by agriculture. That shows there is still very less differentiation of our economy. And then on the best thing is, best scenario for development is, you have to have more labor force and more GDP contributed by the secondary sector or the industrial sector. But in our case, the labor force is still less than 10%. It has this over 10%, now it has come down even less than that. So our labor force is about 6 or 7% in the industrial sector. And the GDP contribution is only about 14%, whereas in the developed country, it has to be over 30-40%. In our case, industrial sector contributes only about 14%. And the interesting thing is in the tertiary sector, now the labor force is only about 20-25%, but the GDP contribution is about 52%. More than half of our GDP is contributed by the tertiary sector. So this change, how do you look into it? On the one side, there is very less differentiation. Still the large labor force is tied up with the agriculture. And even 1/3 of our GDP is contributed by agriculture. And on the other side, the service sector is expanding very rapidly. The GDP contribution is more than 50%. So this is not a very healthy sign. Though this is better than the earlier non-differentiation, at least some differentiation has taken place. But at the development or the expansion of the service sector or the tertiary sector at the cost of the industrial sector is not a very good sign of development. So this shows our economy is getting more extroverted, more dependent, you see, more outside looking, outward looking than inner looking. So if we had industrial development, then we should have self-reliant national development, you see. The industrial sector means a development of national capitalism or the productive capitalism. But the expansion of the tertiary sector means it is a very unproductive sector and it is very much outward oriented. So this way the country's economy is getting more dependent to the outside than we are having a real national independent self-reliant development. So this type of change in the recent years though some people are very happy, are going gaga about the new development taking place, but if you look into it very seriously, there is nothing to be very proud of, nothing to be very happy about. We should focus on developing the industrial sector, not the tertiary sector. Next. Now then we will discuss about the agriculture sector, the industrial sector, the financial sector and the organizing space. These are four sectors I have tried to analyze. Industry, first the agriculture, then the industry, and the third the trade and finance, and the fourth the organizing space. These are the four areas I have tried to analyze in my research work. About the agriculture sector, as you all know, I am not going to give you much trouble with it. You know our agriculture is still a very traditional type of agriculture, a very low development of productive forces. You saw still our agriculture dependent on the traditional factor of production like land and human and animal labor. Most of our, you know, the I hope you, most of you come from rural areas, and you know we still have a subsistence agriculture, and our land and the animal labor is used to cultivate the land, and the cropping incident is very low, so we hardly have one or two crops a year in the Tarai and the middle areas, and just one crop in the high mountain. So the cropping intensity in central is one crop per year. I think even less than that, I don't know the less detail, but it should be around one crop per year. Whereas in a developed agriculture, they have two or three crops per year. So that way our agriculture is very backward, and the low productivity of labor and productivity of land or GBC, that is very low, and the productivity declining over the years. And the predominance of subsistence crops, because cereal crops, most of the crops we produce are rice, maize, millet. These type of cereal crops we produce rather than the cash crop. Though in recent years there is a growing tendency of growing cash crops, but still the ratio of cash crop to cereal crops is very less. Still we are totally dependent on producing of cereal crops. So which has very less productivity, and similarly even then the food surplus we used to have earlier, now we have started importing food from outside. So that way agriculture sector is in serious problem and is stagnating, and only in the eastern Tarai and the Kathmandu valley there are some certain signs there is growing productivity and changing from cereal crops to the cash crops. And in some areas near the roads. Apart from that, if we see the countrywide plain, the agriculture sector is totally stagnating. And if you see the size of the land holding, it is less than 1 hectare. In fact, it is 0.68 hectare of the size of the land holding. With that small land holding, you can have economic development in the agriculture sector. Similarly, if you see the relation of production, the people who own their own land and cultivate their own land constitute 85% of the people. 85% of our farmers are small landholders who have less than 1 acre of land, and they cultivate their own land and for subsistence purpose. That shows our economy in a very dire stage of stagnation. And there is some land being cultivated by rented to others and being cultivated by the landless people, and the mode of appropriation of ground is sharecropping. The 50-50, the tenant cultivates the land, and the only 50% he gives to the landlord and 50% he gives by himself, which is very high share. You see, in other countries also people cultivate land in rent, but the land rent ratio is only about 1/6. From 1/3 to 1/6, but in our case 50%. The sharecropping means 50% sharing. So that shows high exploitation of the peasants still takes place in our country. So, and then the rampant disguise and underemployment. Because of that, there is rampant unemployment and even our youth force are forced to migrate to the foreign countries. You all know. So over the years, it is rising. So that's why our agriculture sector is totally stagnating and it needs total revamping through massive intervention of the state. Next. And if you see the territorial differentiation, there is much difference, but Tarai and Kathmandu Valley are more developed than the hill and the mountain, but the mountain are the least developed in the agriculture sector. Next. So I have constructed this map and taken these 13 regions, mountains, hills, inner Tarai and Tarai, and I have divided into Kathmandu Valley as a separate unit. So that way, east and three east-west regions. So that way we have totally 13 regions. In the mountain, this is the western mountain, central mountain, eastern mountain. The western hill, central hill, eastern hill. So western inner Tarai, central inner Tarai, eastern inner Tarai, the western Tarai, central Tarai, eastern Tarai. This way, the four ecological zones divided into three regions means 12 regions plus the Kathmandu Valley. The 13 regions I have categorized and analyzed. And if you see the agricultural development through the Gini coefficient of operational land holding, cross-classified with percentage of area under ranger tenure. Through this, I have tried to see how the differentiation taking place in the agriculture sector. Because as I told you in the very beginning, my thesis has been that there is a higher social differentiation for higher level of development. If there is less differentiation, there is less development. If there is higher differentiation, there is more development. So this, if you have seen it, then the higher differentiation is seen only in the eastern Tarai and Kathmandu Valley. And the medium differentiation in the middle, in the western Tarai and the eastern, and the low differentiation in most of the area. You see, most of this area, even in the central hill, in the whole of the western mountain and the eastern mountain, there is very low differentiation of the agriculture. That shows agriculture sector is stagnating, totally in the stage of stagnation. Only in the eastern Tarai and the Kathmandu Valley it is dynamic. In the rest of the country, agriculture development is very stagnant. Next. And in this, the district-wise composite level of development I have worked out. I have taken certain indicators of development of agriculture. And through a method of principal component analysis, I don't know any of you of statistics background? Are you anybody from statistics background? No. There is a principal component analysis method. Do you know, any of you know about it? There is a method of principal component analysis where in this method you choose different indicators of development in such a way that then you calculate the correlation between these indicators. The indicators which have higher correlation, it gets more weightage. So the principal component analysis is constructed as a square of correlation of the indicators. If the indicators have a higher correlation, then that will get more weighted and the area will be seen as more developed. So by choosing certain indicators of agriculture development and analyzing through the method of principal component analysis, I have constructed this map, and this shows is a more developed, these the darks are more developed, areas are mostly in the Tarai, eastern Tarai, central Tarai, in the area in the Kathmandu Valley, and then this less second best developed are mostly in the Tarai area, Tarai and the inner Tarai, and this way the least developed areas. The least developed are the western mountains, the most of these mountain areas are the least developed. So this way, agriculture, most of the areas are less developed. Only the part of Tarai and the Kathmandu Valley are developed. Next. Now the question of industrial development. As I told you, industry in the before the Surulip Treaty, Nepal industrial development was not less developed than the regions of South Asia or for that matter any other countries of the world. Our industrial products were competitive with other countries of the region and the world. But after the Surulip Treaty, slowly the factory made goods of India were injected into Nepal. Our market was captured by the British manufactured goods, and our industry started declining. And the process of, I call it, deindustrialization. We were going backwards. Whatever the industry we had, they were closed down, and we started deindustrialization. Our craft, handicraft industry, and artisan production, which were quite developed even outside Kathmandu, all these people, when they couldn't compete with the industrial goods or factory made goods of India, all these small factories or small industries were closed, and these people were forced to return to agriculture or migrate to India for labor service. So that way, after the Surulip Treaty, the industrial decline of Nepal started, and in the 20th century, in the 1923 to be exact, when there was a signs of commercial treaty was signed with British India, which gave special privilege to the Indian side, our industry totally collapsed. Only after the Second World War, during the exigencies of the Second World War, some of the industries were started. First modern factory industry, Viratnagar Jute Mills and other industries, started only during the Second World War. So why Nepal couldn't develop is because for industrial development, you need combination of three factors. First, you need capital. That you have to have surplus production from agriculture and other areas, trade areas, and the capital has to be generated, and the capital has to be in the hand of the capitalists, those who use that capital for industrial production. So in the case of Nepal, capital or the surplus was not in the hand of the capitalists. Whatever surplus was generated through agriculture was mostly in the hand of the Rana rulers, feudal rulers. So they wasted that money in conspicuous consumption. They would import goods from outside for conspicuous consumption. These are the Ranas, they build up all these darwas, all these single darwas, and all these darwas were built by the Ranas from the surplus of the agriculture sector. So rather than investing in industry, they build up the darwas. Of course, we have, at least we have those buildings and can use for our government, outside of the thing. But still, that had been used for industrial development, maybe. They would have generated more jobs and our youth could have got employment here. But the first thing is capital formation was blocked. And the second thing, we need free labor. Free labor was blocked because in our case, we have a subsistence farming. Our farmers are small patch of land, and so they are tied to that, you see. So they will work for 3-4 months, and for 8-9 months, they will remain unemployed. So that's called disguised employment or underemployment. So most of our labor force wasn't released from the agriculture sector. Because of this subsistence type of agriculture, our labor force was not released for the industrial development. And whatever labor force was released was absorbed by the Indian industry, because they migrated towards India. First they joined the Indian and the British armies. When they couldn't be accommodated in the armies, they started working in the factories of India in other laboring work. So therefore our labor force started out migrating towards India. So the labor force, lack of labor force also was the free labor. And the third thing was the domestic market, because for industrial development you need a market. But our market, whatever the capital, small market we had developed, was captured by the Indian factory made goods. Because they couldn't compete, you see. The small scale, the economy of scale, if you produce in a larger scale, then you can sell things in a cheaper rate. But the factory made goods are more cheaper than our small industry made goods. So that way, our industry could not compete, and our internal market was captured by the Indian market. And that way, our internal market lost to the outsiders. So we had neither capital formation, nor free labor, nor the domestic market. Because of this thing, we couldn't develop our industry. So this cases, I have analyzed the various data provided by the industrial survey, and that gives we have a very less development of industries, and most of whatever industry we have, they are mostly agro-based in forest based, small scale industry, very small and medium scale industry. 80% of our medium and scale, small scale industry are agro-based in forest based, and we are very less production food industry. Like the, though in recent years some cement factories and others have come up, but we don't have other factories which can produce production goods. That means goods which can be used by other industries. They are called production goods. Rather than we have consumption goods, and that also more agro-based in the forest-based industry. And the another feature we still have is, as I told you, we don't have free labor. Our industrial labor is still, if you see our industrial labor force, is one member will be working in the industry and the two members will be working in the countryside in their farm. So that type of relation of the labor, they are still attached to our agriculture, they are attached to the rural area. Most of our workers in the Kathmandu Valley who come from Kaveri, Sindhu, Palchok and all these areas, is one member will be here and the two members will be working in their small farm. So this type of labor force is very productive, because you have to be fully dedicated, you see, to your work. That increases your productivity, that increases your skill. But they will work for 6 months, go another 3 months for work in the farm. So that doesn't improve their skill and productivity. So this type of problem always is still there in our industry. Next. And also whatever industry we have is monopolized by few dominant groups. If you analyze the ownership pattern of the industry, though my data is slightly old, you see about 25% of our industry were dominated by a small group, the Marwadi group. Marwadi is very less population, less than 1% of population, I think 0.5% of the Marwadis own 25% of our industry. And then the Newar group, the traditional trading class, they have about 12% of our industries are owned by the Newar. And then the some hill Brahmins and Kshatriyas who are relatively well off, they control about under 12%. So that way, very few groups, and Rana Shah family monopolize about 15% of other industries. So this way, very small groups monopolize our industry ownership, and this type of monopoly, the initial stage of monopoly, is not good for health of industry development. So this is also hampering on the development of the industry. And also we are totally dependent on technological and raw material inputs on the foreign markets, because we have to import everything from outside. All the machinery we import from outside, even the raw material. So whatever the one rubber factory we have built, Chinese are built in Nepal, and all the rubber you have to import from outside. I realized when I visited one industry in Navalparachi, or this YY noodles factory, there they say that even everything imported from India. Even if there is a flour, the wheat also imports from outside, India or Thailand. And even the juice produced there, the real juice and other juice, he said that even the mango is imported from Bombay. So that way, what type of industry we are making? How can we have industry development? If we produce all the things from outside, including the goods we can produce in Nepal. Actually, the agriculture raw material we could produce in Nepal. So this way, our industrial development is being hampered. And if you see in the industrial space, next, if you see territorially, then the industrial development is mostly taking place in the Kathmandu Valley, and this is the Virat Morem area, Morem and Kathmandu. These are the center of, and the recent, now next. But if you superimpose this aggregate industrial development with the manufacturing industry, manufacturing is the big industry, then you can see only three areas. Biratnagar, Birgan, then the Kathmandu. These are the only three areas, though some in the Bhairava, in the recent state, other areas also getting developed, but mainly still we are, these are the areas where our industries are getting concentrated. So that way the most of the countryside, you see the hills and the mountains, there is no industry. So this way, this is leading to very uneven.